It is great to have you here. Let's briefly learn about the Drupal framework and its extensibility. To begin, why do we use Drupal anyway? Well, Drupal gives us a lot of functionality out of the box. Its content modeling system, powered by the entity and field subsystems, allow for complex modeling of the data that has meaning to you. Coupling this with Drupal's pluggable architecture and data abstraction layer makes Drupal unsurpassed as a data management framework. Drupal has a dedicated security team to resolve reported security issues, and they provide guidance on writing secure code and on securing your site. Drupal also provides robust user management features. It's intuitive to manage the users of your site. The permission system is configurable and makes it easy to create various roles with distinct permissions. And creating new permissions with custom modules is straightforward. A significant and exciting strength of Drupal is its third-party library integration potential. Out-of-box Drupal leverages Composer for dependency management, and Drupal already comes with useful libraries such as Twig, Modernizer, Underscore, and many others. As we will learn, you too can add any third-party library you wish using contributed and/or custom modules. All in all, Drupal is a system in which its flexibility can be scaled quite efficiently. If you have not already, explore some of the industries and case studies that Drupal powers. You are likely to find mission-critical websites with considerable traffic and a significant number of users. You can view these at drupal.org/industries or drupal.org/case-studies. Realize that much of the power of Drupal is harnessed with modules. So, what exactly are modules? Drupal modules are sets of structured files that include code to implement functionalities which are triggered by something that happens through Drupal. We are going to talk comprehensively about event triggers in this course. Recognize there are three types of Drupal modules: core modules, contributed modules, and custom modules. Core modules are used to implement the standard Drupal functionality, such as blocks, views, and taxonomy. Contributed modules provide a vast range of pre-built, peer-reviewed features you can add to implement extra functionality in your site. There are hundreds of contributed modules. With custom modules, you create specific business logic functionality that is not generally available through the community module contributions. Modules are made up of PHP, YAML, and Twig files. We will cover all of those as we go. Keep in mind that custom modules supplement the existing Drupal functionality by hooking into the events of Drupal. I'm curious, which modules do you already use? I use plenty of modules in my site building and development work. For example, I nearly always use Devel, which is self-described as a module that provides helper functions and pages for Drupal developers and inquisitive admins. Before I install Devel, though, I install the admin toolbar module first. Another that I always use is the date module. You have probably used or have heard of PathAuto, Token, or CTools. And I, like many others, use Views all the time. Views is now in core, although it started as a contributed module back in the day. I encourage you to read through an old forum post of the official release announcement dated October 17, 2008. A link will be provided at the end of this video. Other popular modules are meta tag, web form, search API. You get the point. Now it's your turn. Pause for a moment and think about the modules that you use. The purpose here is to show that modules are used to add any type of functionality to the Drupal platform. Think of each module as a tool. It can be very small, or it can be very big. For instance, one of the modules I use consistently is the admin toolbar. It's not a big module, but it allows me to navigate the Drupal admin interface efficiently. As you think about the modules you use, begin to notice patterns of functionality. Some of them are utility modules. Others are their own mini application. Many make visible changes to the user interface. Several modules create field types. At this point, if you have been using Drupal for any length of time, you know that Drupal modules can do just about anything you want. In fact, Drupal.org already organizes modules into over 50 categories. Just to name a few, there are accessibility, e-commerce, education, file management, JavaScript utilities, email, multilingual, search, spam protection, and user access and authentication. Wow, I nearly ran out of breath. You can view the full list of categories when searching for a module at drupal.org/project/project_module. One of the questions you should ask yourself at some point is, what do you want to do with your Drupal module development skills? Perhaps you're a current project maintainer and you want to update your module to remove deprecated code or to make it more efficient. Maybe you want to change the functionality of a certain aspect of Drupal. Good news! There already are a handful of established strategic initiatives you can help with right now if you want to. Check out drupal.org/about/strategic-initiatives to learn more. As a developer, you certainly are encouraged to build new functionality, and perhaps you'll even want to contribute a module back to the community at some point. Talking about contributed modules, as you probably know, contributed modules are downloaded through Drupal.org. As a rule of thumb, modules are not backwards compatible due to the API of Drupal moving forward. So, for example, anything that is built for Drupal 9 cannot be used in Drupal 7. It's important to know that the Drupal community does attempt to limit the available modules which provide similar functionality. For instance, since there already is an admin toolbar module available, if you want to create a new flashy module, admin toolbar neon colors, you would be asked to instead contribute your neon colors functionality into the existing module rather than contribute an entirely new module. Now, although you could fork the code of an existing module, that's generally frowned upon for multiple reasons, such as community-provided updates to the source module will not automatically be applied to your forked module. Occasionally, the updates would be security-related, so obviously that's not good. Also, forking could confuse potential users, and forking kind of goes against the spirit of collaboration of open source. So, those are some of the reasons why the community attempts to limit the availability of similar modules. Consider, rather than forking an entire module, examine the specific functionality you need. Can that functionality be abstracted and provided as a module that depends on the other module? One thing to remember about contributed modules is that it's recommended to subscribe to the security alerts at the module's project page. Fantastic! In summary, we've talked about the benefits and potential of Drupal out of box. This includes its content modeling systems, Drupal's security team, the built-in user management abilities of Drupal, and the possibility of Drupal's third-party library integration. Then, we took a deeper look at what Drupal modules can do, and we got a glimpse of over 50 categories of functionality available on Drupal.org. As we continue our learning in upcoming videos, we will explore the systems that truly power Drupal, and we will learn to harness the innate potential available to our custom modules. Take a look at the resources I referenced throughout this video for further context. Happy learning!